The scripture passage of our meditation is taken from the Gospel according to Mark 16, 1 to 8. Mark 16, 1 to 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so that they might go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early morning, early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb and they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man was dressed in the white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene who was crucified. He was risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him just as he told you." Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they heard of him. Here is the reading.
Greetings to you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. At the outset, I thank my tutorial group members and others who have supported, who have contributed towards making this worship meaningful. Let us put to God in prayer. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable unto you, our Lord, our Rock, and our Redeemer. Amen. The chosen text for this evening's meditation may seem to be an appropriate text for a Sunday morning, for an Easter Sunday morning worship, but I will try not to dwell on the Easter aspect and I will not try to speak an Easter sermon. I have deliberately chosen this text and I want us to spend some time to reflect upon certain events or certain expressions as found in the given passage and to reflect upon them and see the lessons that we can draw for our Christian living as well as for our ministry. I would love not to go into all the details of the background of the text, but as I said, I will highlight certain selective events that happened on that day as given in this passage. To put it very, very briefly, we see that in this, as we read this passage, the passage tells us that after Jesus was buried, on the morning of the first day of the week, three of the women, namely Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome the wife of Zebedee, who had helped Jesus during Jesus' journeys on earth, went to the tomb to do perhaps the last honors to the body of to the dead body of Jesus. But as they near the tomb, or as they reach the tomb, they discover that the tomb is empty. So we read that, bewildered, amazed, and afraid, they ran away. This is what the passage tells us. This passage has, of course, many, many implications and can be interpreted in many, many ways. But I want to point out just four expressions from this passage and want to reflect upon them and draw some lessons for ourselves. The first one is from verse 1. We read that the women prepared themselves with fragrant preparations to go and do honors or to go and anoint the dead body of Jesus. These women, as well as many other women, were devout and very faithful followers of Jesus during Jesus' ministry on earth, and they were faithful unto his death. Their love and duty, and their love and loyalty for Jesus was such that they wanted to prove it even after Jesus had died. But to prove this, to anoint the body of Jesus, was not an ordinary task, nor was it a very easy task. We understand that there was obviously fear, there was obviously insecurities surrounding all around, especially after what had happened to Jesus, and fear and insecurity with especially the followers of Jesus and his disciples. And we can conclude that no one would dare to venture out to go to the tomb this soon or that soon. But we see that these women are determined. They are determined, they are loyal to the point that they take the risk to go out. And so on the first Easter morning, we see that these women walk to the tomb, go to the tomb with fragrant preparations to do honor to the body of Jesus. We are living in times where fears, where insecurities surround us everywhere. As Christians and as theological trained people, we are afraid that we might be persecuted someday, somewhere, somehow, because of our faith. We are afraid that we may find ourselves in trouble if we tell the truth, if we stand for justice, if we stand for truth and equality. We are afraid that our careers may be destroyed if we give in, if we do not give in to the wishes, the demands, the fancies of the rich, the poor, the rich, the powerful, the influencer. We are even afraid that we might hurt people, or maybe certain people amongst us, certain people in our congregation, if we question or if we challenge their unethical lifestyle and so on. I think the way that our world today, our society today, is structured and is functioning, has become a place where it is increasingly becoming very difficult for us Christians, for us theologians, to truly honor God, to truly love God in thought, in word, as well as in our actions. So a question that this passage suggests is, do we love God enough? Do we wish to honor God enough that we may go beyond our call of duty? That we may honor Him and value Him and the kingdoms, the value, the principles and values that of the kingdom of God, even if it becomes risky, even if it becomes dangerous, even if it is inconvenient and difficult. We may find ourselves in different situations anywhere, in different situations where we may have to choose in order to prove our love, in order to prove our loyalty, dedication to our Lord. And when we are determined, when we truly love God, when we truly want with all our hearts and our minds, if we truly love God and want to honor God, I think we will. Where, as the saying goes, where there is a will, there is a way. I think we will find ways and means to express them in our personal lives as well as in our ministry. We will find ways to honor God by honoring the whole of God's creation. We will find ways to love God by loving others, even the others that are not one like us, even the others that are not included within our community. So honoring and loving God, it is suggested that it also means that we do not compromise on what Jesus has laid down, on Jesus' principles of truth-telling, of peace, of love, of equality and justice for all, despite the consequences. Secondly, in the third verse, we see the question, who will roll away the stone? Who will roll away the stone? The women are saying amongst themselves as they prepare to go to the tomb, who will roll the stone away? We can understand that it is reasonable enough, it was natural enough for these women to worry about the difficulty that lay ahead of them, to worry about the stone that was ahead of them. It was natural. Women, as being the weaker gender, especially physically, the stone was big, the stone was huge, the stone was heavy, the stone was strong, was too strong for these women. And it may seem that they would eventually have to come back without doing honor to the body of Jesus. But as they went forth, we read that the difficulty that they feared, the difficulty that they were talking about was moved. The stone was rolled away. God had done for them what they could not have done for themselves. In a sense, I think these women are us as we walk through life. Very similar is much of our experiences in our everyday lives. In our daily lives, in our ministry, in our as students, as teachers, or anybody else for that matter, we find stones in our way, in our daily lives. We are discouraged, perhaps very quickly, by thinking of the future possibilities, of the difficulties that lie ahead of them, and we get easily stressed, tensed, or we become afraid. Stones that hinder us, stones that stand in our way, can come in different forms. These stones may come in the form of hardships, may come in the form of struggles, financial problems, health issues, low esteem issues, failures, remorse, anything. It can come in the form of failures. And we cannot move the stones, each and every stone on our own. And sometimes some stones become just too heavy for us. But this passage that we have read assures us that there is no stone too big, there is no stone too strong, there is no stone too heavy for God to move for us. He removes our difficulties, He removes our fears if we allow Him. Our lives may never be perfect. I think we can never have the perfect life ever. Our lives may never be perfect. There may be always stones that hinder us in our way. There may always be stones before us. But I think God's grace gives us wisdom. God's grace, that itself is a sign of God helping us remove the stones before us. God gives us wisdom. God gives us understanding. God gives us strength for us to cope with, for us to deal with our imperfections, for us to accept our imperfections, and for us to move ahead in life. Another question that came to my mind as I studied these texts is, why did the women in the first place decide to take this risky business of going to the tomb that early? Why did they prepare these pregnant preparations? I think they knew that what they were going to do was not very safe for them. I think they knew that the stone was very big. I think they knew that there would be nobody to save them, to help them roll the stone away. But why did they become so courageous or bold to decide to do that? In a way, in a sense, we might even say that they were like maybe perhaps very stubborn women, very unreasonable women, and maybe even foolish to attempt to do such a thing so early after what had happened. But I think when we consider their action, we have something to learn from them. I think, as I said, out of their love and duty for God, and also they ventured out, and also they went out in faith. They had faith, I believe, that somehow, somewhere, there will be a way out. I think they believed deep in their hearts, knowing the possibilities of the impossibilities surrounding, knowing that what they attempted to do would be futile. But I think deep in their hearts, they somehow had that belief that one way or the other, or perhaps they believed in some way out, or a sort of a miracle. Otherwise, I don't think these women would have gone to the womb so early in the very first place. So for me, and I think you agree with me, what is admirable, what is worthy, is their bold faith. And such faith is something that I think we all need to continue to nurture and develop. Thirdly, in verse 6, the man in white says to the woman, "He has risen, he is not here. He has risen, he is not here." This verse does not tell us anything about how Jesus rose, or when he rose, or the kind of physical form that Jesus took after he rose. But this verse tells us that Jesus rose and tells us where he rose, or tells us where he was. The young man says to the women, "He is risen. He is not here." So it is right for the women to be looking for Jesus, because Jesus was supposed to be in the tomb, but the tomb is empty and Jesus is not there anymore. So it is right for the women to be looking for Jesus, but they were looking for Jesus at the wrong place. So they are told by the man, young man in white, that Jesus would be found in Galilee, the place where they lived and worked. I think it is important to point out that the fact that the place Galilee is specifically, particularly pointed out means something to us. I think it implies the fact that Jesus is to be found in the midst of people. Jesus is to be found in the midst of relationships. Jesus is to be found in the midst of activity, where people meet, where there is relationship, where there is communion. So the implication thus is for us to be one of God's people, or for us to claim ourselves to be one of God's people, is that we are part of a group of people. We are not just an individual. Our relationship with God is not strictly vertical. It's not just a relationship. Our relationship with God is not just a relationship between just God and the individual person. There is also a horizontal relationship. And this horizontal relationship is beautifully witnessed and lived out in the life by Jesus in and through his life. It means that we are part of the people of God, and part of our Christian identity is to be connected relationally with other people. Part of our Christian identity is that we have to have connection, is that we have to be in a relationship with people. The Bible says nothing at all about an individual by himself or by herself. What we are called thus is to be connected to other people, is to be connected to others in relationship, just as Jesus did, is to be in a relationship with people who are also connected to God. God's value system, we have a long list of the value systems of God, and one of God's value systems is about relationship. And I think many times we have said, or we have thought, or we have thought that Christian character and being holy or holiness is about following spiritual rules. We have thought that character and Christian character, Christian identity, Christian holiness is about following spiritual rules, such as praying, such as fasting, such as reading the Bible, such as singing, going to church, and so on and so forth. And we have not said much, we have not thought much about the significance of relationships. But according to God's value system, according to God's principles, it is not possible for us to love God and not love other people. It is not possible for us to be connected with God and be remain connected with God's, with others and the whole of God's creation. We cannot love God and be disconnected from Him. We cannot love each other and remain disconnected with each other. The fourth expression, or the fourth point, in verse 7, the man in white says to the women, But go tell his disciples and Peter. I want to first focus on the words, but go tell. The man says, but go tell his disciples and Peter. I think the women were not prepared to hear this. They were not expecting this to happen. I think this was not the role that the women were ready or prepared to play at all at this time. We know that throughout Jesus' ministry, these women and other women had been following Jesus and ministering to him in his hour of need. But at this point of time, I think they are not prepared, or they were not prepared to go out and tell. And living in a patriarchal context, patriarchal society, it is, I think it was beyond their call, beyond their duty, beyond their role. In other words, it was not within their role. It was not the role of women to go and tell. I think going, telling were all the business of men. So we understand that we assume and we would conclude that they were not prepared. They were confused, afraid. And another at the same time, who where? Where do they go? As I said, there was obviously fear and insecurity everywhere, and probably the disciples are in some hiding place, praying that the authorities do not find them. Go then, go where? And another thing importantly, tell what? What would the women tell? What would the women tell the disciple Peter and others? He's not in the tomb. Jesus has risen. No, we didn't see him. But we are told by some man that he is risen, he is not there. I think that would be like, what kind of message is that? And who would believe them? Or would people believe them? Would people believe this message? So we read that trembling and bewildered and amazed and afraid, they ran away. And this is how the Gospel of Mark ends, the story of the good news ends. But clearly at some point, somebody said something to somebody. And when we take the whole four Gospels into consideration, the combined records, the combined stories give us a more detailed and clearer picture of the resurrected Jesus. Again, like the women at the empty tomb, in our secularized context, in our secularized times, in our times of persecution and threats, in our times when there are too many people questioning, challenging the claims of the truth of the gospel, when there are people who are not interested in following and knowing Jesus, we may find ourselves asking the same question. We may find ourselves in the same similar situation like the women. Go where? Tell who? Do what? Despite all our theological training. And again, these women perhaps felt insignificant, little, because of being women, they might have felt pretty insignificant, pretty unprepared, and little to be telling, to be proclaiming such a great message. And perhaps sometimes we may feel the same like the women. Because of different societal contexts or constraints, there may be times when we may feel insignificant, when we may feel little, when we may feel like nobody. But all of us, each and every one of us, men and women, black and white, rich and poor, old and young, all of us are called to go and tell. Go and tell to those people who have not known what we know. Go and tell people the stories about what we know about Jesus, that which they don't know. Tell stories about life that God gives into the world. Tell stories of how of injustice overcome by justice. Tell stories of hatred overcome by love. Stories of violence overcome by peace. Stories of death overcome by resurrected life. One way or the other, we are all called to go and tell. No matter how what we feel, no matter how high or how low is our self-esteem, we are one way or the other, we are called to go and tell. Because God seeks our involvement. God wants to move, God wants to change through us. If we want to see Jesus ourselves, if we want others to know Jesus, we have to go out. One way or the other, we have to go and tell. Finally, this verse also ends with an offer of forgiveness. When we look at the words of the young men to the women, but go and tell the disciples and Peter. We see here that Peter's name is singled out by name. And we know that Peter had failed Jesus. In Mark chapter 14, verses 68 following, we read that Peter denied Jesus, not just once, but three times. Thrice, Peter denied Jesus. Peter disowned Jesus. Peter said that he had no connections at all with Jesus. Yet, in this verse, we see that Peter is singled out. Go and tell the disciples I'm Peter. I think this is a clear sign that even Peter was forgiven by God. Peter was singled out for God's grace. And again, the message is clear for all of us. God's forgiveness is open for us. There is nothing that we have done in the past that God cannot forgive. His grace is open for anything that we have done in the past against Him. He can forgive Peter, He can forgive you and me. This is the good news for us even today. And again, sometimes we cannot move forward in life again because of certain stones in our lives. These stones are also in the form of regret, are in the form of shame, of guilt, in the form of sin, self-blame, etc. We cannot remove all of these stones. We cannot undo the mistakes that we have done. We cannot erase the hurt that we have caused people. We cannot undo the bad decisions that we have made, the wrong judgments that we have made. But this passage again assures us that God is willing and able to remove the stones, because these stones hinder our personal, our spiritual, our psychological, our emotional, our mental growth and maturity. If we allow God to work with us, God will remove these stones for us. We are assured that the grace of God forgives us and gives us a chance to move forward in life with Him. May the good Lord bless us and use us as we live out and witness the good news. And may the good Lord bless us all.
For may the God hear of your good and perfect gift. We lay out His offering of our money before you as a symbol of our love and devotion. Bless their use and our service within the church and in the world through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Shall we say the Lord's Prayer together?
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
As you, O Lord, has blessed our coming in, now bless our going forth, and hear that when we come, your house be made not only the presence, but may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of the God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us. Amen. Shalom.